Hey guys, welcome back to a brand new episode of Stand Up Sit Down. On today's show, I have the hilarious, the talented, the beautiful Lourdes Gonzalez. Stay tuned.
You are now tuned in to Black Hollywood Live. Stand up, sit down.
Okay, okay, okay. I feel like you put this, I feel like you put the song on like when you're getting ready.
You do.
This is like the get ready song.
This is it, cause you can like still jam, but like get your makeup all
right. Right.
You know, you with it. It's a vibe. It's a movement.
Yeah.
It's good music, man.
God damn it, LouLou.
Hello.
If you guys who are faithful fans of this show, you know back in 2013, 2014. Lourdes, because I'm just going to use your government. Lourdes came on as a guest. We had a fantastic interview. Mm-hmm. And then a year or so later.
It wasn't even that long.
It felt like it was like a year.
It was 3 months.
It was not 3 months.
I crushed that show.
I want to say, you guys can check the tape. She was my co-host.
Yeah.
And we were rocking this.
We was.
For a while.
What happened? You broke up the group.
You left. You left and decided to get popping. That's what happened. You were like, you know what, Nick? I'm fucking Justin Timberlake in this thing. And I'm getting out. I'm getting popping. I was like, wait a minute. I wasn't ready.
Hey, but you see, Justin comes back and does reunion shows.
Right.
You see, I'm here.
For like, he does two songs on the Super Bowl halftime, and then, you know, Joey Fatone all off beat, off step, losing.
Exactly. That means I'll be only here for half of my interview. Carry the rest.
Welcome back.
Thank you.
Let me start off with this. So, Lourdes and I had this wager.
I'll bet.
A few years ago. Mm-hmm. And this was like, it's actually on one of my vlogs. So you guys follow me on, you know, YouTube, whatever. You can go back and watch that. Mm-hmm. But we had a bet that, I haven't watched the footage, but I don't believe I said this. But Lourdes said.
He said that I promise you in 2 to 3 years, you will not be famous. Nobody will know who you are. Like, it's not going to happen for you. You're going to have to wait. Actually, you told me it's going to be like 10 years. You told
me. I don't believe I said 10
years. Go back and watch the vlog.
I don't believe I said 10 years.
But you just didn't believe in me. That's why I left. It was hard to come in here every day and work with somebody who doesn't believe in your success.
Here's the thing. Reverse psychology is one of the best things in the world. And, you know, I truly do, because I've watched your just growth, right? Your sets, everything. Like, it's great to, like, watch someone that you know killing it. Because we've done shows prior.
Yeah.
And you've killed it.
Thank you.
And I'm like, yo, like, I gotta step my game up. You know what I mean? Because, like, as a comic, and you do a show, and when you have, like, friends on the show, it's like, all right, cool. But then when they get on stage and crush it, you're like, okay, wait a minute.
I don't know from your perspective, but I've had a lot of guys come up to me and be like, the fact that you're a female and you kill the show makes them want to, like, work a little bit harder. And I was just like, thanks, I guess. But I
mean, that really didn't do anything for me, because, like, I don't care if you're like a man or a woman.
Did it?
No, like, it really didn't matter. Okay. It doesn't matter, because, like, to me, funny is funny.
Okay.
So regardless of gender, like, I don't care.
Hey, you're one of the few.
Yeah.
You're one of the few. There's a lot of guys that, like, send me messages like, you shouldn't do comedy. You should just be sexy in slow motion. I've gotten that. I was like, oh, great, thanks.
I mean, here's the thing. I'm gonna be honest with you. Your Instagram photos are fantastic.
I had to become a girl. This tomboy life really wasn't kicking it for me no more. You know, I had to learn how to put on makeup and heels this whole thing. It's a whole thing when somebody doesn't believe in you. You have to change everything. I had to change every aspect of who I was.
Well, I'm glad I was there to help pioneer your growth.
Thank you.
That's really what it was.
Thank you.
It was me pioneering your growth for you to become the beast that you are today.
Thank you. Now tell me I won't get an Emmy.
Okay.
I need that motivation.
So the bet was.
Oh my God, you did it!
This was the bet. The bet was had to wear her face on a shirt. So I paid for this. She sent me a photo. And I'm gonna, so you can kind of see, I don't know if you kind of see it, this is a picture.
Hey, that's a badass shirt, man.
So, you know, holding true. Because again, like I said, I am a friend.
So people that didn't know, the bet was basically, I told them that I would be famous in 2 or 3 years, at least be known.
Right.
And that if I won, that he'd have to wear a shirt with my picture on it.
Right.
And you are a man of your word.
Yeah. I mean, well, here's the thing. I'm not going to wear this every day because I'm what I'm going to do, I will give this to you. I'm wearing a undershirt, so I will give this to you.
Wow.
You can like sign it and give it out to one of your fans or something. I don't like wear,
and
keep
that's
it
smart.
Or whatever you want to do. This is me holding up my
actually, you
my
know
end
what?
Of
How about,
bargain.
You know, I'll sign it and then you'll sign it. And then we'll give it to somebody who's been a faithful follower of the show.
Yeah.
You know.
That'd be dope.
That's my contribution. You're welcome.
All right, so let's get into this interview.
Let's go.
For those of you who don't know Lourdes, born in Brooklyn.
Yes, sir.
Right? New York.
All day.
No, that's the Bronx, my bad. I'm not from New York, I'm sorry.
I'm from Brooklyn, East New York. Stand up. Star City's in the building. We made it. Made my hood famous.
What was that like? What was like growing up in New York?
Growing up in New York, it was so diverse. It was like the epitome of what real hip hop was. Like I started breakdancing like from like 2 years old. My mom said I would be pop locking on like cardboards.
Do you still breakdance?
Nah. I could moonwalk. But I learned that from Brooklyn.
That's not
moonwalk. Pop locking. What's really in style now?
I mean,
moonwalk will forever be infamous. Okay.
All right. I see that.
But Brooklyn was just different. It was the home of where you get roasted. Like I think kids don't even have that no more. Like nobody's getting roasted anymore. Like I used to get roasted every day. Like you know. So I took that, and then you throw it back at people, and that's how I built character. Like. So that was interesting. You know. I moved out of Brooklyn.
So, but like, what kind of kid were you growing up? Like a bully, class clown, mean girl. You a nerd?
I was a class clown / nerd.
Okay.
If that makes any sense. Like, I liked school, but it was more fun to make everybody else laugh.
Right.
So I would make everybody else laugh, but like silently do my work. Like, at the same time.
Like, I'm still going to turn this in.
Yeah, I'm still going to turn this in. Like, you could cheat off of me, but I'm going to get these jokes in, okay? I was the girl that would like, crack jokes, but then like in gym class, I'm like on the team of all boys. Like I'm like playing basketball, playing baseball, playing steal the bacon. I'm the best. Like I had a lot of competition in me, so I would always want to play, and all the other girls would like want to sit and play like with each other's hair, and I'm like, steal the bacon is happening right now. Like, I'm a beast.
Get out here and get this.
Y'all not gonna come get this bacon. Like, I'm always been after the paper for some way. So that was Brooklyn was different. I would always like play outside. You know, then nobody was like indoors. I had a lot of friends, played kickball. It was like, but there was like rapists in my building, so I couldn't like go outside like after six.
Yeah, because that's dangerous.
Yeah, it was dangerous, but the daytime was fun. You know, so that was life in a sense.
So it made you to the woman you are today.
Yeah, well, that was a stepping stone.
Gotcha.
That was like the first building block onto the foundation. Like, we're gonna give you some hood cred. At like six, so we can move forward in life.
And then you joined the military.
Mm-hmm.
And what prompted that? Like, what made you say, I want to serve the country, yada, yada, yada?
I was broke. I was dead broke. I went to college and nobody told me. I thought I was going to go to college on scholarship
because
I play ball. So I was like, you know, basketball is life. I'm going to go to the league. Like, I'm going to go to Duke. Like, this is it. And nobody told me that you needed to have good grades to play in college. I just thought, I'm nice. They don't want me. That didn't work. So I went to college like off of like, this is the only school that accepted me. Shout out to Virginia State University. And my dad was like, we can't afford to send you to school. It was like $14,000 a year.
Right.
And I was like, well, he's like, either find a way or you going back to Brooklyn. So I joined the National Guard. It seemed reasonable.
Mm.
And everybody was like, yeah, it's great for you. You don't even got to do nothing. You just come 2 weeks in the summertime, 1 week in a month, and you get paid to go to school. Then I went to Iraq.
It's like, wait a minute.
Like, I was like, I thought we were supposed to put up sandbags in a hurricane.
Right.
And I was like, now the hurricane's in Iraq. You can go over there. So that was interesting.
So, like, but when you got that call, or that, because I don't know how they do it, but is it a call or is it like, hey, you need to?
Well, my unit, the way they did it is like they try to trick you. Like, because a lot of people, when they found out, like, we're being activated or we're being deployed, they would try to, like, leave. Like, yo, I'm not answering my phone. I'm going to leave the country for a little bit. Like, I had people, like, really, like, just trying to ditch out.
Right.
And then they would be like, yeah, no, just come as a, like, a formation. Like, we just need a quick formation, something crazy. We just need to talk about some things. And then we got there because they have us now. And they're like, boom, here are your orders. You guys are going to Iraq. And we leave in, like, 3 months to get ready. So say goodbye. And I was like, damn, I just got a car. In my head, I was like, I really don't have like time for this. I was like 20. Yeah. I was 20 years old. I wasn't even legal to drink.
Wow.
And I was getting ready to go to war. I just complained a lot. I complained every day. I was like, I don't want to die like this. Like, I have to like go live. I thought I was gone. I was like, this is my story. Damn. This is it.
So then after your 3 months is up and you're like on the plane headed over, what were you thinking?
I don't know. You know what's it's crazy? Most people probably won't understand this, but in my head, I was like, I'm going to be a hero, okay?
You like watch Rambo or something? You watch like a bunch of stuff?
I prepared. I was in the mirror like practicing how to hold my guns and shit. I was like, oh, I got this. Like, you know, I'm ready.
Yeah.
This is what Brooklyn prepared me for.
Right.
I was like, I'm going to go to war. Like, I'm going to get home with like a star or something. I'm going to be a hero. That is not like what happened. That is not. I got on the plane and like I was crying so hard. Like I had a homie, rest in peace. Actually, he was like putting me on my back. He's like, "It's gonna be okay." I was like, "No, it's not. I don't belong here. I'm 20 years old. I'm supposed to be drinking." But then after a while, it was like it became the new norm in a sense, because it was like I'm there every day. I had an Xbox, you know. So,
so was it like civilian life kind of, or is it because you like see pictures during like the Super Bowl or whatever, it's like, oh, like, you know, our men overseas are like watching the Super Bowl and like they look comfortable. I mean, I don't want to, that sounds terrible, but like it looks like it's,
I mean, in a, we try to portray it's comfortable because you never want to let anybody at home know what's really going on. Like, you don't want to know how miserable I really am.
Right.
But they have certain things to make you feel like you're back home. Like, they have what they call an MWR room. It's like where you do all your, they have an Xbox. It's like two Xboxes, a ping pong table, and a place to play cards. And that's how you go relax. Okay.
Okay.
That's it. You serve our country, take an Xbox, you know? Like, that's not what I needed. And then they had, like, certain bases have, like, a little movie room where you can, like, just watch random movies. But it'd be, like, movies from, like, 10 years ago. Like, I don't want to see Look Who's Talking To. Okay. I want to see, like, Avengers.
Brand new. It just got it, guys.
So, yeah, you're, like, succumb to, like, all right, I guess I'll watch this talking baby to relax my mind. But it wasn't really nothing that would make you feel like a civilian. I would break the law. I'm a snitch on myself. I would order, like, Victoria's Secret, like, lotion and pajamas, because you're not supposed to wear civilian clothes at all.
Right.
You know? So I would, like, when I have, like, my room, like, the room was, like, half of the studio, and I would order, like, things to make me feel pretty and like just lock my door and like put on lotion and like cool pajamas in my room. And then when everybody like comes to knock on my door, like put on my army uniform real quick and be like, oh, no, everything's normal. Everything's normal. But if I would have got caught with it, they would have like, you know, they would have ripped me up.
Oh, but like it was mailed to the base.
Yeah. But it doesn't say, it wouldn't say Victoria's Secret. It would just be like a white package and I'll have my name on it. And so, or sometimes I'll get real creative and like send it to my mom and then make her repackage it and then just send it to me. So I had like my setup to get my Victoria's Secret lotion.
So it was kind of like you were in jail.
It is.
And trying to sneak commissary or whatever.
Yeah, it's like, it's jail, but like with your friends. Like if you got,
I mean, some people in jail have their friends.
But they were my friends before. I didn't meet them there like, we should be cool because we in the same cell. Like,
right.
But it's like, it got like a little camp. It's camp with death, okay?
Yeah. Jesus.
Sometimes okay. Camp
yeah.
is death.
Okay? Yeah. So then you got out of the military.
Yes.
And is that when you started doing comedy?
Actually, I started doing comedy
while you're still in military.
And that's what made me want to do comedy. I would do comedy for like my friends, my battle buddies, and just to kill time because everybody would be like stressed out or taking things too seriously. So I would be like cracking jokes like on like missions and stuff like that. And somebody was like, you should do stand up. And I was like, whatever, I don't want to do stand up. I was like, I don't want to do that. That sounds stupid. And it was like, come on, you should do it. And then one day I was just like, all right, I'll try it. But in my head, I was like, I want to be a serious dramatic actress.
Okay.
So I want to do theater. Right. I want to do Law and Order SVU. You know, that's what I want to do. I was like, I don't want to tell jokes.
Are you happy that you started telling jokes now?
I am thrilled that I started telling jokes for a living. It's the best. It's so therapeutic.
Yeah.
It's instant gratification.
Yeah.
And the hours are great.
You can sleep in.
I can sleep in. Right. You know, I can eat whatever I want. I can drink whatever I want, you know, and I can still live my life, you know? And sometimes life inspires my work.
Very true. So what was the first show like? The first actual legitimate comedy show that you were like, all right, I'm like going to do this thing for real.
It was horrible, but good at the same time, if that makes sense. I had to take a loss in a sense to realize that.
So it was a bomb? Is
I didn't bomb. That's a good thing. Okay. I didn't bomb, but I was like highly intoxicated because somebody told me if you drink a lot, like your jokes would be better on stage. Never believe that.
No, it's the worst advice ever.
That's the worst. And I took it and I had like two drinks. I had my jokes written out. I didn't know how to set up jokes, you know? So I was just like all these cool concepts.
Right.
And I went on stage and I just started talking and people were laughing, but I don't, like halfway, I started to like get a little like, a little woozy. So instead of having a cool 5 minute set, I had a cool 2.5 minute set. So I was done in like 3 minutes, you know? And the host didn't know what was happening. He was still at the bar getting his drink, and I was like waving at him to say, I was like, I'm done. You can come now. I had no etiquette. I was like, yo, I'm done. You can come take the mic now.
This is it. This is it.
And then he didn't come, so I just left the stage. So,
wow.
Yeah. And that made me feel like, I was like, I can do this again. This is easy.
But you didn't drink prior to going on stage again.
No, I don't do that no more. I never, like, after that, that was, like, such a big lesson.
Yeah.
I was like, I will never, I want to be sober as hell.
Yeah.
I was like, I'll drink after, but I was like, I'm never drinking before, ever.
What was the first bomb like? That face right there tells me that there's, like, you went, it hit you.
I never forget that. Honestly, yeah. I think about that day. And I had a show last night at Flappers, and I was talking to somebody about this, too, and I was like, damn, I hope me talking about it doesn't make me bomb on stage. The first bomb, unfortunately, was in New York, and I was trying to show out. And I was trying to do some new jokes and everything, and New York crowd's a little bit different than L.A., and I had to realize that really, really quick when I was trying out this new material. And I was trying it out, and it was so flat, and I had to do an act out, and I ended up on floor, on the floor, and by the time I got up, like, everybody was just sitting there looking at me like, and I hear people in the background talking like, is she done? And I literally just like, I was like, yo, I'm done. Shout out to your host. And the host was actually a homie of mine. And he came on stage and he was like, I tried to like dap him up or whatever. He was like, don't dap me up. taking that L. And I was so embarrassed. And actually, Talent was one of the headliners. Mm. He was a headliner. And I ran into him afterwards. And I was just so excited to meet him. And I was like, oh, did you get a chance to watch my set? He was like, you're the girl who bombed, right? And I was like, yeah. And he just like patted me on my back and he just walked away. I was like, why? Well, but that was my first and only bomb.
Nice.
Proud to say.
Nice.
Never took an L like that again.
That's good.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's almost like you're kind of due. I don't want to say it, but I'm just saying.
I'm due for one?
Yeah.
You know what? Thank you. Now it's on tape. Look at all three cameras. Thank you so much. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, we have on record of Nick really just all not believing in me once again.
No,
you know
again.
What? Because of that, I promise you, you want to make another bet?
Sure.
I promise you within 2 to 3 years.
Okay. Well, this is 2017. So then by no later than 2020.
No later than 2020. I will be on a network show.
Okay.
Either a network show or a stand-up special.
I feel like you can get a stand-up special in the next 24 months.
24 months?
I believe that, honestly, yeah.
No, so, don't believe that. Give me hate.
Give
me hate.
Take the stand-up special off of the table. I will say network show, I will bet you on that. Stand-up special, that, I believe
okay,
you can.
Okay, 3 years, network show?
Yeah. Not Netflix, not Hulu, not Amazon. I'm just throwing all these out. Not cable. Has to be one of the top
network show.
Five network shows. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, yeah.
One of the top five.
Yeah.
Okay.
And not a pilot, but a pilot that gets greenlit. And you need at least on air.
What
three
are
episodes.
The stipulations?
I'm just saying. Because you could be on a pilot and the pilot doesn't go, and then you're like, then that doesn't count.
All right, but what if it's a show that gets picked up?
Yeah.
And I'm not a series regular?
No, you got to be recurring. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I'll take this bet.
Okay.
I need a new wager because, I mean, clearly we know that I like to speak things into existence, and it's clear, it's working.
All of my game.
It's working.
And I've said this on Twitter, I've said this vocally, that, you know, like, I want to do anything that I can to help my friends mm-hmm. succeed, because I really, like, I enjoy watching my mm-hmm. friends do well. Like, it's...
Okay, so this is what I would like. When that happens, I want a life-size poster of the show that I'll be on.
Okay.
Like I want the poster of the show framed in your house.
Framed in my house.
Framed.
The only poster I have framed in my house is a show that I have worked for, Brooklyn Nine-Nine, on Tuesday nights on Fox, from back April 11th.
Shameless plugs.
But all right,
I want that.
All right, but you have to sign it.
I would gladly sign it. I'm gonna wear my mink coat and I'm gonna come over and sign it.
All right. Okay. Speaking of shows, because mm-hmm. like I said, you're popping now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you got the little blue check on Instagram.
Actually, I don't. Not yet.
I saw a blue check somewhere. Didn't I see
you? You did?
I feel like I did.
Somebody call my manager.
Did I not? unless I'm looking at the wrong Lourdes.
There's another one?
Unless I'm looking at
I mean, actually, there is a girl who stole my old Instagram account. And
did she really?
And now she's holding it hostage for me.
No, she's not. Seriously?
She told me, she's like, if you want your old account back, we can work out.
Seriously?
Yeah. And I was like, you can have it. It's not that serious, but okay.
What was your old Instagram account? I mean, well, don't plug it.
You go to my new Instagram account, which is LouLou_Gonzalez. Yeah, but she, like, stole my whole account and was like, yeah, if you want it back, we can work out something. I was like, oh, you can keep it. It's not that serious.
Wow.
I'm a prosper over here.
Yeah.
You can keep that. Well, I was actually really flattered. I was like, oh, that means I'm moving in the right direction.
Yeah, you're doing something right.
Yeah, and I got a fan page. I'm like, this is crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, you got a fan page?
Here's the thing. So you're a following now. So you did Vine.
Yeah, I did Vine.
Right? Mm-hmm. And was this something that you, because I know there was like a big thing between stand-ups mm-hmm. and then like people on Vine, and there was this like kind of...
I've been waiting to talk about this topic forever.
So you hopped on Vine, like mm-hmm. what was it, like something that you wanted to do, or was it because you saw social media going a certain way, or like what was the...
Actually, no, I hopped on Vine by accident, and mm-hmm. It was when Vine first started.
Oh, wow.
I wasn't on no wave or nothing. Actually, King Batch, shout out to King Batch.
Bachelor, fellow.
Yes.
I just like Bachelor. He's
in Meet the Blacks and that other good stuff.
Touring with Joe Coy, too.
Yeah, he is. Yeah. Actually, and he's prospering in stand-up. He's one of the few from social media that actually are not funny.
Right.
So he hit me up one day. He was like, yo, you want to come do a Vine? And I was like, what the hell is Vine? And mm-hmm. he was like, it's this cool little thing. 6 seconds, won't take long. I was like, all right, cool. Came through, shot a couple Vines, and then next thing I know, I'm on Vine doing Vine. Okay. And from there, people would say, a lot of stand-up comics who I would know would like literally tell me to my face, Vine is stupid, it's not real comedy, everybody just wants to be a comedian, as they're not like cherishing the art of it, I think it's stupid. And they would like literally clown me, but I'm like, all right, cool, I'm gonna just go do Vine and I'm gonna do a show. Like, you know I can do both.
Right.
And now we have every comedian in the world thinks they can do Instagram videos and
the tide has changed a little bit.
The tide has changed so much, and it's funny because now it's the same people that was clowning me and asking me, like, what are you doing? That's stupid.
Right.
Are now, like, trying to do videos. And I'm like...
Well, I mean, but there's also money to be made, though.
It is, but it's kind of like you're late now.
Right.
You showed up to the party late. The party's over. Everybody's gone to the after hour spot. We're done. We're done with this. We've played here. It's over.
So when Vine went under, mm-hmm. or went black, essentially, mm-hmm. what did that do kind of like for the community? Or was everyone gone already?
The people who were doing Vine from the jump, it didn't bother them. They were done. Like, nobody really cared. We was off of it anyway. We was focusing on Instagram sketches. And now everybody's focusing on their own little things, their own little projects.
Right.
So people who are now trying to hop on, it's like, I don't want to do that with you. I did it already.
How important, as a stand-up, mm-hmm. how important do you think social media is to help build your brand and this and that?
Oh, I think it's hugely important. I mean, when I post, like, I have a show coming out, come check out my show, you know, my followers, they'll come. They'll actually come out and support. And you keep your audience in tune to what's really happening, what you got going on. Like, I'm so much more than just sketches, you know?
Right.
I can do other things. This is what I really do. Come see what I do.
Come see me live.
Come see me live, you know? You don't have to, like, hit rewind or hit refresh, you know? You could come see me live. It's actually really fun. But I think it's important, man. I think if a lot of people would capitalize off of that and understand that versus trying to do it for the likes, mm-hmm. and try and do it for, you know, attention or trying to just get the pay instead of just promoting yourself.
Right.
It would go on a whole different aspect. It would go on a whole different avenue. But people are more concerned about the likes.
And going viral. Right.
Versus actually just putting out good quality stuff that, you know, portrays to their brand.
But you recently had a video that went viral.
Yes, I did.
You had a couple.
Yeah.
But let's talk about this young mop, or young M.A. I don't even know how to say her name.
I think it's young M.A., but
young M.A.?
I say young ma.
Right.
Because I feel like to me, just, first of all, it's so complicated. And this is what made me want to do the video, because I felt like that whole concept is complicated.
Yeah.
And just a disclosure, before anybody says anything negative, I was not making fun of her or sexuality or anything like that. I was not clowning her because she's a lesbian. That doesn't really matter to me. What I was clowning was the whole aspect of her relationship with her male friends that I'm looking at from on the outside in, and what I've heard other men say. So,
that's funny.
Yeah. I've heard, like, the reason why this started is because I was, like, standing with some other comics and we were just talking, and I heard a couple guys was like, yeah, you know, I'd still, you know, I'd date her. She has a cute face. And I was like, but she clearly likes women. And they're like, yeah, whatever. A couple of shots and she'd be down. Like, she's cute. She wouldn't. And that got me thinking. I was like, what would happen if young mom was like, really, like, this was like the greatest scam ever. pretending to be a lesbian so you could have all these cute, handsome men around you that you could just have sex with at your disposal. And then be like, no, I'm a lesbian. It doesn't count.
We're not dating.
We're not dating.
What is this? Right.
You're my boys.
Yeah, we play ball.
Yeah, you know? So I was actually saying kudos, you know, to the greatest scam ever. But
no, yeah, it's a dope sketch. And then you did a music video.
Yeah.
You did like a parody. I feel like you should, and then... If you can get her to, like, do something with you, that would be super dope.
That's so funny, because this morning I woke up to a comment on my YouTube page. Mm-hmm. It was from her.
Oh, shit.
But I don't know if she didn't, like, watch the video. Maybe she thought, like, I was paying tribute to her in some weird way. But, like, she commented, and then when I went to go look at it, like, I was going to snapshot it and put it on Instagram.
Right.
And I went back, and, like, she deleted the comment. So I was like, did she, like... Then watch
commented
it.
And then watching was like, nah.
Son, I can't support this. It was like I got happy and sad in the same second, but I was like, well, at least I know she watched it.
Right.
That's all I really wanted.
You're on your radar now.
That's all I wanted.
That's the thing.
That's all I wanted. Like, it went to World Star.
Yeah.
Which was hilarious.
Yeah.
I saw myself on World Star doing rap. Like, I had a rap video on World Star, which is the craziest thing in the world.
You made it.
I made it. That's what everybody comes telling me. You made it. Like, thank you, community.
Like, everybody in New York is like, yo, she made it.
I had people texting me like, yo, son, you made it, son. We so proud of you out here, yo. And I was like, okay, thanks. I mean, but I did a music video. The music video was about a minute and a half, almost 2 minutes. I wrote my own lyrics. I did the beat, you know. I did her whole cadence like it was that song of Ooh. Mm. And I just titled it Oops. Oops. But yeah, it did 2.6 on Facebook, 2.6 million on Facebook. Went to World Star. It was all over like Vlad TV. And actually, shout out to Sin Santana, Joe Button's girlfriend. She DM'd me and was like, you're funny as shit. I was like, thanks.
Nice.
Hey, girl.
Nice.
And then that was it. Yeah, I was like, okay.
Joe, get on the track.
Yeah, Joe, me get and Joe Button's on the track. That's right. What I need.
Because he's from New York, right?
He's from Jersey.
Same, almost, no, I don't want to say, okay, sorry.
Walk out of this interview.
I'm not from New York, guys. I don't know the coasts.
This coast is
because I feel like Jersey and New York is like right there, but there's like beef, but there's no beef, but there's a little beef.
It's like Oakland.
And like Fresno or something?
Nah, like.
It's like Oakland.
We're not like in distance, but like Oakland and California, like LA.
Okay.
And it's like to us on my side, it's all LA. But to you, it's like, no, it's Oakland. It's, we don't care on our side.
So, like, when the New Jersey Nets moved from Jersey to like Brooklyn, that was like a thing.
It was a thing. I mean, we loved it because it was like, cool, Brooklyn got its own team now.
Yeah.
And Jersey don't got nothing. but they still suck. So,
yeah.
They didn't change much. Thanks, Hov.
But you also did the series on All Def Digital, mm-hmm. The Kellys.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yes.
It was you, Layla Odom, and Cynthia Luciette. There you go.
Yes.
How was that?
It was great. Next question.
How Men Become Dogs.
Yes. I love How Men Become Dogs. It was actually on Issa Rae's channel.
Yep.
Hi, Issa. I need a show.
How did that come about? Would you just audition for it, or was it just like...
The creator, Mark Cunningham, we did a short film together, and we had so much fun on a short film, and afterwards he was like, man, I have a role that I think you'd be great for, and I didn't question it. I was like, whatever you write, I'm pretty sure it's going to be amazing, and I got to, like, be a different version of myself, so that was cool, but he was just like, yeah, I just want you to, like, have fun on set. Like, he gave me the script, but it was like, you know... Follow it loosely, do what you want.
That's nice.
He gave me creative freedom with it, which was brilliant. And he was just like, just do what you want.
Yeah.
And I love the title. It was just like, How Men Become Dogs. Like, I would love to see what really happens.
Cause how they transform from men.
Yeah,
into...
so I can kind of like catch it if I see it with somebody else, you know? It was like a tool. So, but it was a good time. They're actually on another platform right now. Showing like old episodes.
Nice.
Yeah, so that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, your name is out there.
Thank you. I Google myself.
As you should, because, you know, just to see what
is
else.
Is that bad?
I do it too.
You do?
Yeah.
What comes up?
A couple other people who aren't me, and I'm like, okay, listen. No, there's this football player. I want to say he's a college football player now, and he's like decent. You know what I mean? So like his name is like in the papers and shit. I'm like, okay, listen, hey, bro. You gotta...
Would you ever have an alias? Like a nick? Like, I know you call me by my full government.
I use the alias sometimes, yes.
Do you, like, for stand-up, or?
No.
Or just on paperwork?
Well, not, no. Like, if I'm, like, out somewhere, or if I, like... No, okay.
I mean, professionally, not when you go to Big Wang and you're trying to pick somebody up, like, my name is Johnny.
No, because, like, Nick Perdue, like, that's what I'm going with. That's what, because it's like family legacy, so, like, that's really, you know.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Yeah, my agent told me, he was like, Lourdes seems like a lot going on. Like, he's like, just go with LouLou, because LouLou was basically like a family name. Like they gave me that. Like, and as I got older, it was just Lou.
Right.
So when I started doing stand up, I was like, just call me LouLou, because people were always messing up my name. So when my agent got with hold of that, he was like, you know, just go with LouLou. Like, it's easier, it's catchy. He's like, just stop using Lourdes, and I felt some type of way.
So like when you do movies, you want them to credit you as
no.
LouLou?
When I do movies, I want them to credit me as Lourdes. Like, when I'm on that network show in 2 to 3 years,
you want it to
it's
going to
say Lourdes, because I work too hard for this name. And I want to see that in all its glory.
Or do you want it to say Lourdes and then in quotes LouLou?
I'm not T.I. You know, I hate when
Like people do that. Like,
I hate when I see. Yeah, that. I know. When I go to the movies and it'll be like whatever his name is, but T.I. Harris. Like I don't.
Clifford. Clifford is his name.
And they just go by Clifford, okay? Cliff.
But there's a little, you know, there's no like streak to that.
Or just go by T.I. Don't start off
T.I.P. though, because it was you know, the whole Q-tip, so he had to.
What?
Yeah, you didn't know that? That's why you did
no.
it.
No.
Yeah.
Are you serious?
I'm serious.
That's a real thing.
That's like you can Google that.
I'm not Google.
You can look that up.
I'll Google my name again. I put on random things in Google, and then like my name will pop up with like some other chick who's like in Mexico, and I'm like, all right.
All right, well, as long as you're not, like, smuggling drugs, then you're fine,
I
right?
don't know.
Well, yeah, okay.
This is Mexico.
All right, well, you know, here's the thing. You also did the rollout, right? The Foxhole radio
yes.
show.
Yes, Sirius XM. I got to do the Jamie Foxx's morning show.
How was that?
It was amazing, man. It was 5 days a week. You know, we was in there.
It was like a job.
It was a job. It was a serious job. Like, yeah. I had responsibilities. I had my own segment on the show. You know, I had, like, obligations.
Yeah.
We went to Bike Week in South Carolina, and we got to do two shows out there, and I did our live show, and I got to mix and mingle with some people. But it was great. You know, working with Jamie Foxx was amazing. Like, he was so down to earth, so cool. And I got to, like, hear some music sometimes, like, that was, like, not on the album that he was, like, trying out.
That's cool.
I was like, oh, you should get Drake on that.
did you go to any of those infamous Jamie Foxx parties?
No, I didn't. I was always around when it was, like, wholesome family time. Like, go to his house and, like, play basketball, like, with his nephews and the wife and everybody's there. Like, I never got that side.
So you didn't get the, like, the, like, turn up Jamie? Like...
No, I didn't. I would have loved to seen that.
Yeah, I feel well. He may be going back to that. I feel like that's, you know, because he's doing stand up again, or he's gonna start doing stand up again. And that's what I heard. Word around the water cooler is
I would love to see that.
He's gonna get back into the whole stand up situation. So
I would love to see that.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like he was a good stand up.
Yeah, he was.
And then he started doing music.
Yeah, I mean, when he was doing stand up with the music, little riffs in it was funny. You didn't think so?
I mean, I was just a fan of I Might Need Security.
Of course, who
like,
was it?
That was my, like, I here's the thing. I taped it illegally because I didn't have cable, right? But we had cable. We didn't have, like, the HBO or whatever. So I would tape it, but it would just be, like, a black screen with, like, the squiggly lines. So, but I could hear it fine. And then it would, like, come in a little bit for, like a quick second picture. Yo.
Wait, did you get the extended, like the extended cut too? Like when it would be like the extras at the end?
No.
Oh, it was on the DVD.
I was nine at home re-recording Jamie Foxx on HBO.
Okay. I love it. I think would I be pushing it too much by saying it's a classic?
No, it is.
It's okay. It's a classic.
Yeah. So he needs to come back. You know, Martin went back on stage. Chris Rock is on tour again. Chappelle's, you know, got this special coming out.
Netflix, yeah.
So I feel like, you know, Jamie.
That's who I would love to work with. I would love to do some sketch comedy with Dave Chappelle.
That'd be dope.
That'd be, like, that's what my agent tried to use to sell me. He's like, I think I see you as, like, a female Dave Chappelle. I was like, I'm going to stay with you. You got big dreams for me.
If you can give me that Comedy Central show, though. Right?
I would love that. I would love my own sketch show.
That'd be dope.
I get to do whatever I want.
Yeah.
With a budget. It's different when you have a budget.
It's totally different when you have a budget.
I learned that when I started shooting myself. Everybody's like, yeah, what are we doing for lunch? You go home? I'm not buying you nothing.
You can Postmates, though.
You can post on your bill.
No. Or you can Blue Apron.
Oh, right? Good segue.
Right? You can do that because Blue Apron is the number one fresh ingredient and recipe delivery service in the country. Blue Apron's mission is to make incredible home cooking accessible to everyone, even when you're shooting sketches with the friends.
I wanted to try that, actually.
You should, okay. Because, you know, they've established a partnership with over 150 local farms and fisheries and ranches across the United States. So as a result, seafood is sourced sustainably under standards developed by a partnership with the Monterey Bay Aquarium Seafood Watch.
What?
Yeah.
For real?
And cooking together builds strong family bonds.
They do.
So.
Yeah.
Use Blue Apron. You can go on blueapron.com with free shipping. Go on blueapron.com/use STAND as the quote or as the little link, and you will get a discount or something. I feel like that'll.
I think they have to give a discount because
something will come up. But you go on blueapron.com/STAND and cook your meals, guys.
Yeah. Their slogan should be, we're better than the microwave. You guys owe me. Send me some free food.
Blue Apron, where the apron doesn't get dirty. Use us. Because we're the best.
Yeah, I actually saw them. I was like, man, I was hungry today. And I was like, I wish somebody would just deliver me food. And then I saw like a commercial like that on the internet. And I was like, I need that.
You need that.
I need that.
So you should go on blueapron.com/chess.
Are they going to give me a discount or something?
I mean, they should. That's what they should do.
That's a good job. Look at you.
Listen. I'm proud of you too.
I am
trying every day.
You are growing up. You're turning into, you know, a really great, you know.
I'm forever 19, so don't ever tell me I'm growing up.
I know, because you got here late.
I was here on time. Okay, I was here right at 4:59.
No,
you know, I walked in at 4:59
because you have that shirt on. There's nothing I can be mad at you about.
Yeah.
You know, because I really thought you like flaked on the shirt. So I was
did
like,
you really?
Yeah.
Well, we had this whole like conversation.
Yeah,
online.
But you told me. But then you just said me right now. You was like.
But I was wearing a jacket. I feel like I was like, she's going to like see
I
through
didn't.
This whole
you
terrible.
You know why? Because I take people's words for what they are. And I thought you was an honest person. So I'm looking at you. I'm like,
I lied to you in your face.
You did.
I really did.
Welcome to America.
I'm that terrible friend that lied to you in your face for your own good.
And then you have a great
so
surprise.
So we can get that. Because it was really, I'm glad we got that reaction. That was a genuine reaction.
I did not. No. I was like, damn it. I was like, that's what I told you. I was like, I will come back on this show
to
see you have on my shirt.
Yeah.
You did a good job. That girl looked good.
I mean, it's all lighting, really.
No.
Lighting in a push-up bra? Is that what it is?
No. Those are real.
Those are real.
No push-up at
no,
all.
No,
and
no
guess what?
Wonder.
No wonder. No lighting. That was taken in a hallway.
But you're lit. Are you not lit in this?
No, but that's natural light.
That's the hallway light?
That's the hallway light. That's with the 7 Plus. On portrait mode, if you take all your pictures on portrait mode, you too can look like a fashion model.
Okay, well stop plugging because Apple's not paying
iPhone,
anybody.
Give me some more stuff.
They're not paying anybody.
No.
As we wrap up, because I know you have to go, you're busy, and like I said, you're popping now. What has been the coolest moment in your career thus far?
Oh, wow. I have a couple. One was actually working with Jamie Foxx, and he was working on his iHeartRadio stand-up, and I was at his house.
That's dope.
And he was showing us, like, his bits. And he was like, you know, asking for like, you know, tags and stuff like that. And I threw out a couple of tags. I didn't know if it's Jamie Foxx. I'm like, he's not gonna really use my tags, all right?
Yeah.
And I threw out a couple of tags at him, and he just looked at me and said, "You're funny." He was like, "It's funny." And then I just stood there and I just looked at my homegirl and I was like, "Jamie Foxx said I was funny." And I was like, I went into the bathroom. I was like, "I'm good, man." Nobody could tell me nothing. And then I saw the show, and then he did my tag on the show.
Nice.
And I just sat there and kicked my feet up, and I was like, I made it. Like,
yeah.
So that was like a real cool moment for me.
No, that's actually really dope.
It was like I pat myself on the back that day. I was like, he only said 2 words, but he listened. So, and then after that, he told like the host that was on the show, he was like, "Yo, me and my homegirl, actually Kanisha Buss, he was like, those two girls are funny, man. He's like, you found some good ones." So he like really genuinely appreciated that we were just like real like comedians. So
that's dope.
That was cool.
That's dope.
It's probably one of the best movies.
What is the biggest lesson you've learned?
The biggest lesson I've learned is to be persistent. Just when you think it's over, it's really not.
Yeah.
Because every time you give up, you might be one step away from actually achieving what you really want. And I've seen that time and time again. This is a hard business, you know. It gets on your nerves. It gets depressing. It gets hard. It gets really hard. And sometimes you just want to quit. And every time I've had that moment that I want to quit, something will happen. It'll keep me going. So it's just like, stay persistent and stay, like, remember what you came out here for.
Yeah.
And why you're doing it. And that's it. Just stay forward. Stay moving forward.
Keep pulling you back in.
Every time I'm done, like, pull me back.
What is the best piece of advice you can give someone who either like wants to start on this Instagram joint or wants to start doing stand up? What would you tell them face to face right now?
It sounds so cliche, but be yourself. It sounds so like, oh, that's so easy. It's so easy to get lost in this business. Mm. It's so easy to do what the next person's doing. It's so easy to say, I want what they have, so I want to look like they look. I want to be how they are. I want to act like they are. I want to steal their whole swag. Be confident in your own swag and be you. That's what makes you your best, I think, the best comic. Because nobody can tell your story. Nobody can tell your jokes. Nobody has seen life through your eyes. Yeah. So just be you and be confident in being yourself and be happy being yourself. Because you got to be yourself for the rest of your life. And that's if you're going to be a faker, then you have to live with being a faker, being a fraud. Can't go back I can't go back to Brooklyn being a fraud.
Crazy. No, no, you can't. You can't at all.
I got the hood on my shoulders. I got
Woo. Yeah. You and who else is from Brooklyn? I don't know. I
know Zaynab Johnson's from Brooklyn.
Okay.
And that's it. That's all I know. I don't know anybody else. But yeah, we're a few out here in these LA streets.
Yeah, doing it.
Trying, we're doing it, yeah.
And so where can people see you live?
You can see me on my YouTube channel. Every Tuesday I'll be releasing a new video. It's you can go to Lourdes Live, or you can just go to my Instagram at LOU underscore Gonzalez. And yeah, I'm posting everything up in there, and I'm trying to have my own sketch show.
Do you still tweet?
I don't. I know, I hopped on the other day and you like slid in my DMs. I was like, you know, so crazy. It took me so long to, I didn't know how to respond to you.
Seriously?
I was figuring out like for 15 minutes. I was like, how do I even send a response?
I mean, it hasn't changed.
It really has though. I was baffled and I got off quickly. That's why I text you. I was like, hey man, just text me.
What do you mean? Because like I thought I had your number and I was going through my phone and I was like, okay, I don't have her number.
Oh, so you got bougie.
I didn't get bougie. I got another phone.
I had the same. That's a lie. Because if you don't have an iPhone.
I don't have an iPhone.
I say it's in the cloud, but that's
yeah. No, it's this is
that's
this
probably
is,
on this the is, porch. Like
wow. It's in the rain cloud, and it falls through every 3 months if you don't back it up. It's basically what Google's trying to tell you. Like, listen, you got to back this up. I'm like, nah, I'm good.
Nah, you need to back it up. Yeah, I was like, I was mad at you. I was like, he got bougie.
Wow.
He doesn't even know who I am anymore. Like, you don't have my number.
I follow you on everything, though.
No, you don't. I don't never see a like, a comment, or nothing.
Lion Monica Lewinsky, you know good and well.
I am not Monica.
You know good and well. I feel like I liked the last thing you posted.
Negative.
Well, I mean,
then what was the last thing I posted?
Well, here's the thing. The last thing that I saw that you posted on some form of social media was talking about your a waist trainer video.
Oh my God, that's so long ago. Which
I
actually
thought it was
got
like a couple weeks ago.
Actually got 2 million views on Instagram.
And then you posted something like there was like another video. Like I didn't watch the full thing, but like I saw it. But I know you posted another video. It was like it was with the same people who were in the waist trainer video.
That's why, because it was in the same day. I shot the thing the same day.
See, so like I'll follow you. Like,
yeah, I did a video about how girls act when they get their hair done.
Okay.
Which was so stupid, but like did so well. It's like.
Yes, I'll listen. I'll put your notifications on.
Yeah, turn post notifications on.
That's
come
what you
on.
Is that what you're supposed to do? You're supposed to
yes.
do that. Right? All right, I'll do that.
I need you to do that because you need to keep track of what's happening with that in the next 2 years.
That's what deadline's for, though.
I know.
If I just happen to, because I'm on deadline every day. So if I happen to go on deadline and I see your face, I'm like, holy, I gotta buy this poster.
I will gladly come in with my mink coat. I'm wearing a mink. I'm just going full camera on. And I'm you know what's so crazy? People always tell me, oh, please don't change, you know. When you make it, please don't change. Please just be who you are. I'm letting the world know right now.
You're changing.
I am changing.
Okay.
I will change. I'm changing my number. I'm changing my address.
Don't do that because I just got it again. So you got to keep it specific.
Slide back in my DMs.
Text me. Let me know. Be like, hey, listen, Nick. So I got on the show. Here's my new number. Delete the old one.
I'll do that for you. I'll do that for a couple of people. But I think in general, I can't wait to change. Like Jay-Z said, I didn't work this hard to stay the same.
I get that. My number will probably never change. I do have another number, but like my number that everybody has will never change.
Yeah, no, I have to change because I have bill collectors that call me now because I haven't made it yet.
I mean, you gotta pay a little something.
No. Wait, when I get the show, I'll pay them off. But until then, Catch me if you can. I'm Leonardo DiCaprio. Okay?
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate you, Lourdes.
Of course.
Thank you. Thank you guys for watching. Of course, you could find me all over the internet at the Nick Perdue, and now at the Nick Perdue 2. See you next time.
From executives Kevin Undergaro, Dario Kristen, Tiana Hobson, and the entire BHL staff, we would like to thank you for supporting Black Hollywood Live, the first online broadcast network dedicated to African-American entertainment. For questions and comments, contact us, info@blackhollywoodlive.com. Like us on Facebook, tweet us, or Instagram us at BHL Online. And I am the official voice of Black Hollywood Live, Scipio, Instagramming, at KingXOBay. Thanks for tuning in. The views expressed here are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of BHL or its owners or principals.